Bro, I need more power.
Did this take place during World War II?
Not actually. It takes place after World War II because, number one, there's a whole plot point about a couple of rowdy Japanese youths who don't basically want the American military presence out of their country. And the character there in white is, we find out he was a failed kamikaze pilot who randomly got dropped into Bison Well. It's not going to make any more sense when you watch it. I'm sorry. It's six episodes of interesting ideas that mostly turn into, what does this have to do with anything? It just doesn't, it doesn't work well. It's visually it's stunning. It's a gorgeous looking series, but so much of the plot is just nonsense. Had I not been watching this in conjunction with Dunbine, I would not recognize half the terms they throw out. Like, Dunbine kind of explains things, but, like, there's a concept for the show, which is mentioned in passing. It's a people of Bison Well called the Garo Ron, who are basically spy masters. They're unreliable people. They throw that out in Wings of Reem with no explanation. It's like, this guy smells like a Garo Ron. What does that even mean? I'm sorry, that's a little much, but it's the idea of, this is a show which assumes you know Dunbine intimately, or you know Bison Well intimately, and it just doesn't, it gives no border. It's, you're going to have a hard time finding it anyway. This got released by Bandai Visual, which is a company that is deader than dead.
And their releases were infamously expensive.
Oh yeah, prohibitive.
And not even worth it.
You might be able to get the old Pat Labor movie releases, which are actually, for what you're
those
paying
ones
for,
actually did get pretty cheap.
And yeah, honestly, you can get them for like $20 now. For what you pay for them, you get a good deal. You get the remastered movie, you get like the storyboard booklets. Mm-hmm. But most of their stuff is hard to find now for various reasons. Most of their stuff, honestly, wasn't that good. It's their big claim.
I found pretty much all of them for under $20.
Cool. Yeah, so
it's not that hard.
Basically, it's the Pat Labor movies and Gunbuster are really their only releases that are worth much. Maybe MS Eagle if you're a Gundam completist, but that's about it.
Didn't they do the Super Robot Wars, the Bug Wars anime?
Yeah, that's.
And, like, each disc was, like, $50.
Then Media
Blasters. Had, like, three episodes on them.
Flash forward to Media Blasters, pick up the rights for that, you can now get it for, like, chump change at Best Buy.
No, they died
before that series came out.
Yeah.
But yeah, this was to date our last journey into Bison Well. And actually one other thing I will give this is this was probably Tomino's most direct jab at his country's nationalist past. Mm-hmm. Both in terms of like the main antagonist is kind of misguided from the fact that he never got over the war, partially because he kinda got thrown into Bison Well in the middle of it. And honestly, the two guys underneath him right here are basically the two friends who are trying to, basically, they kind of do the get out of our country America thing, which, on the one hand, I can almost sympathize with the sentiment, except the entire idea is they're sort of misinformed idiots in the course of the series. These guys are basically ready to wipe out Tokyo just to make their points. They don't realize they're kind of the ends justify the means. If we have to let our country burn, I'm okay with that. Yeah, so it's safe to say if there was any doubt that Tomino hates nationalists, this show blows it out of the water. Anyway, we're going back to the 1980s.
Oh boy. So let me tell you about Elgato.
So Andrew and I have made a whole
rating system
based on this show.
So Elgaim, 54 episodes is actually kind of a...
It's his longest show to date.
Yeah, and I don't know why. It's a collaboration between him and Mamoru Nagano, who you may know from the Five Star Stories.
Which basically just sort of turned into a refined version of this. Art style is more out there, the power levels are more broken.
He always likes to say that Five Star Stories is not Elgaim's tale. So it follows this dude named Dabamai Road, who's just Luke Skywalker with dark skin, who's trying to get revenge for his kingdom or something like that.
Really? I don't remember that. I don't remember much of the show.
Because he's King Colas from...
Basically,
Five Star Stories.
He starts off as just this random guy exploring the wasteland. He gets mixed up in a planetary rebellion, which... It's basically a galaxy-hopping version of what he'd already done with Zabungle in a lot of ways, except with fancier mecha designs and a lot less humor.
Well, it tries to be funny, though.
It tries to.
Like, literally one of the first things you see in the show is a panty shot. I'm not kidding.
Actually, for him, that's still tame compared to Raiden. Raiden kind of overdosing.
So the reason why we say that this thing made a hole, we made a rating system based on this, is we've determined that this thing is the absolute median as far as a mecha anime can be. It is not good, but it is not bad.
It's
watchable.
Okay.
You can watch it.
Like,
but you're not going to be like enjoying it, but you're not going to be hating
it
either.
It's not the show you're going to spend a lot of money to own, but if Media Blasters ever does that, you can get half the series for $20. Yeah, it's not a bad way to spend $20.
So we've made a rating system called Better Than Elgheim and Worse Than Elgheim.
And sometimes things are equal to Elgheim.
Sometimes things are equal to Elgheim.
And I think the most telling thing about this series as far as its legacy is, other than the five-star stories connection, it's basically the biggest filler show for Super Robot Wars.
Yeah.
Yeah, this, if you've ever played any of the PlayStation games, they loved this one.
Yeah.
Yeah, this thing was also kind of a test run for Zeta Gundam. A lot of the archetypes are kind of there.
Which actually is probably as good a time as any to go into that slide. This is just a few visual examples, but basically a lot of Zeta and Double Zeta. This is around the time where they finally they broke Tomino, they got him to come back to Gundam.
Yeah.
And he basically just took a lot of everything he'd done before and he just reskinned it, repurposed it, and redumped it back into Gundam.
Who was the red-haired girl in Elgheim again?
Galha Lissi.
No, L, L, begin with an E,
who?
I think.
In what?
Elgheim, red-haired girl.
That is Galha Lissi.
Oh, yeah. She was basically like proto-Emma Sheen.
They got, like, Todd Guinness and Dunvine is basically a less jerkish version of Jiren Mesa. They basically turned Yazan into Timp and Double Zeta Gundam.
The Fom was basically Fa. Or Fom, Amu, whatever her name
Amu.
Was. Amu, yeah.
Actually, one which I know people are probably going to contest, but honestly, I'm convinced. I think the prototype for Haman Khan is actually Haruga Ajiba from Ideon, who is basically arguably even more of a cold-blooded bitch.
With a little bit of...
For reasons which I can't go into because it's a huge spoiler.
And a little bit of Poseidon.
Yeah, it's basically Zeta and Double Zeta. Again,
Poseidon was so confusing.
Yeah. They are perfectly watchable shows, but you can basically, as you start going through more stuff, you basically realize he just kind of cobbled this together from everything he'd done before, which kind of lends the idea that he's
I would say
to be fair, Zeta Gundam came out pretty damn good.
Yeah.
Double Zeta, I love Double Zeta. It's goofy. It's fun. It's got Ryuluka, who's the best Gundam girl.
I would rate that better than Elgheim. And there's a Ryuluka cell in the dealer's room.
I'm gonna take a look
at
that.
We'll discuss it after because we're down to 15 minutes and we're about to get into the rockiest part of this man's career.
Uh-oh.
The 90s.
Uh-oh.
Dun, dun, dun. This, actually, more than Garzy's Wing, this is the show where I wanted to know what happened behind the scenes.
Also a joint of knocking out.
Yeah, Brain Powered is one of those ideas that sounds great on paper. You've got the creator of Mobile Suit Gundam. You've got the guy to the neck for Five Star Stories. You've got music by Yoko Kanno. It's a power team. And this show is a mess.
It's like you took, like, each person was doing their own thing, which were fine on their own, then you throw them all together, and it's like...
Honestly, I'm watching this...
Supposedly Yoko Kanno had no idea what the show she was doing the music for was about.
I think the best way to sum up what's wrong with Brainpowered is, and if you watch the show, you'll notice this, it feels like they wrote a 50-episode series. We're told they can only air 26 episodes, and basically just went... Okay, that one, those four, that, staple those two together, cut that one, yeah. Doesn't even make any sense. Look, we're under budget, slash and burn.
Yeah, it has probably the worst examples of Tomino's patented conversation dodgeball.
Let's put it this way, without giving too much away, the first episode has a 1 year later jump to the end. And I mean the end of the series, I mean to the end of the episode. The main character, one of the main characters of this, he's part of a group called the Reclaimers, which is, it's your antagonist group of the series. He starts off as a villain, and you'd think, this would be a great arc, the idea of this guy kind of looks and realizes, man, we've been doing the wrong thing all this time. You never see that. You just jump to him defecting at the end of the episode a year later. Which, again, I think they just had to cut a lot.
Also, the opening theme song, extremely catchy. Then you realize the song is just about a woman who wants to have sex forever.
And I didn't include the opening because I think I had to mark this panel 18 and up because there is a lot of casual nudity.
It's so weird. It's fun in Super Robot Wars. The Brain Powers are so much fun to play as, but it is weird.
Yeah.
It's weird.
There's a lot which I want to like about the series, but it only lives up to maybe 25% of its potential. There is stuff that gets introduced and dropped. Like, there is a arc built about this character's got a cancer which could kill them. it's sort of forgotten about after a while, and he
so
just
it's like the room.
Oh God, I wish this was like the room. Although it does have a similar terribly acted English dub, thank you Bandai Entertainment. You could probably find this one for cheap down there.
Oh, I'm sure.
I mean, even though a lot of Bandai stuff right now goes for a king's ransom because secondhand dealers will poach the hell out of you, I don't think they tackle too much for this.
No.
Although in some ways it kind of was a test run for his next show, which was Turn A Gundam.
Yeah.
It definitely does have a lot of callbacks. And
actually, a lot of the actors were in it, and they had Yoko Kanno too.
Actually, one of the other things which I really like about the show, and it's frustrating, it's so bad, is the biological mecha element. There are, basically, you see them organically grown. There's not, like, factories that make these things. And they essentially, they interact with their pilot like it's a child. It needs encouragement, it needs growth, it needs guidance. It's a cool idea, and it's executed well at points, but the finished show is just not worth all the mess. And then he kind of went off the grid for a while after Turn A Gundam for a couple of years. And then he brought us this. And here's where we bring to the final clip of the night. Because there's no King Gainer discussion where I can't show you this. I need a King Gainer! And yes, he wrote the lyrics to this song.
Also, songs by Yoshiki Fukuyama of Jam Project and Macross 7's Fire Bomber.
Oh, I love it.
You know, this game was right. Holy crap! That's awesome!
And congratulations, this will now be what you associate this show with forever.
Yeah, Doug showed me the other one he got.
And again, this is actually one of those shows he did where it's not a war story. It takes place after a disaster, which they kind of scroll by in the opening credits. Most of the world is now a frozen wasteland, and everyone's living in this. It's essentially domed cities. There's local governments, but the biggest controlling interest is transport. Like, the trains and transits control everything. And in the middle of all this, there's a group which, they call themselves Exodus. The entire idea is they want to get out of these domed cities and basically start a new life outside this controlled environment. Yes? That's actually one of the things I was going to get into, is thematically they do share a common ground of the idea of break outside.
I was going to say, similar art style.
Similar art style. They share the thematic element of explore the world, break outside your little preconceived notions. King Gainer is a lot more on the nose of it because the main character, Gainer Sanga, is, he's a recluse, he's a shut-in. He, basically, the entire reason he knows how to pilot a mecha is because he is a video game whiz, and it just so happens the control interface is similar. Mm-hmm. But the idea of his parents died, he sort of reverted and shut down, he kind of has been living alone, he's a latchkey kid. He literally gets dragged into the plot because he's arrested for being, they mistake him for a Exodus agent known as Gain Bijou. He meets Gain in prison, the two break out, and he kind of finds himself this unwilling accomplice on this plan by these people to break out and find the lost land of Japan. Yeah, the names aren't that subtle on that front, but
I think it's Russia.
It's honestly, it's a pretty fun series. Sadly, it's hard to find now because, again, Bandai Entertainment owned the rights and no one's tried to plunder that grave yet.
Plus, you gotta love that opening sequence. I mean,
it's a show that really takes itself none too seriously. There's a couple of dark moments. A character does kill themselves rather bluntly in one scene.
I was going to say, there's a fun fact about the opening. I think Tomino told the story at one point where, like, he came up with the lyrics and the song, and they were like, "What? You're kidding about that, right?" And he has the whole opening done already. And they're like, "What?" He's like, "Behold my power."
Oh, yes, we'll actually be seeing that coming up at the very end of this. But yeah, that improper is the only other show the only other works he has since done besides this were all Gundam related. And yes, I do have to agree with this man. I think Reconquista in G was kind of trying to tread similar ground to King Gainer. How well it does it is up for debate, I argue. I think King Gainer does it better, but I will give G Reco points for trying.
The problem with G Reco was you're exploring this like you're in this unexplored era of like between the Universal Century and what would eventually become Turn A Gundam, and you're not really explaining that.
It's actually supposed to be after Turn A Gundam.
What?
Yeah.
Really?
Because
no!
Because it was meant to be after.
Bullshit! How?
But there was a James Gunn at the beginning.
Honestly, part of the problem here is also the fact that we're talking about trying to go into the in and outs of Turn A Gundam, which I don't think we were ever meant to know. It's
I think that was meant. That was a, I think that was a translation mistake when they said
either,
after Turn A.
Either way, though, it's I don't think we were actually meant to know more about Turn A. It is what it is. Accept that. Move on. But yeah, that kind of brings us to the end of his works as a head director, which brings us to question and answer period.